I wasn't always as perceptive towards wrestling as I am today, and a lot of factors have played into why I love it the way I do. I was not a wrestling kid, as they would say. I did not grow up watching wrestling through my school years. I don't even think I knew of the Attitude Era. All I was told that it is a violent sport with no positive impact on an impressionable child. And so, it was banned from my household. This until a late afternoon in 2007 alone in my house, where I stumbled upon a WWE programming on TV. For the next 2 years or so, I would comically hide my addiction from my parents and friends, dismissing it to be a guilty pleasure of sorts. What I did not realize was that I was 100% connected not to the action, but to characters and storylines. Stories such as Jeff Hardy's rise to the top, a moment etched into my memory as one of the best things to happen in my life. He was my favorite, but I still did not look at it through the lens of an art form. That ability was nurtured in me years later, around 2017, when after a break of 7 years, I stumbled back upon wrestling, starting to steadily grasp onto the shifts in style in WWE. The gritty tone of late 2000s shifted to a clean, more refined TV. The athleticism was something that I had never seen before. The newly branded developmental zone of WWE, called NXT, features stars of sizes half that of your usual wrestlers. All of them from different parts of the world, with abilities unique to not just wrestling, but to anything I'd ever witnessed. I remember being blown by Shinsuke Nakamura in NXT, a Japanese wrestler with an aura, a presence that draws you in through sheer charisma and his brand of combat called Strong Style, a style popularized in Japan. Obviously, I knew nothing about these terms. The fact that I was missing out on these amazing historic roots was just, I felt shameful. And then, something really strange happened. It was nothing short of my very own cultural phenomenon that I was desperately in search of, and it was happening right in front of my eyes. People all around the world were buzzing for one event. That event taking place very close to home, right here in Asia, in Japan. A wrestling promotion called New Japan Pro Wrestling held its summer show Dominion, and one of its matches was being hailed as the greatest wrestling match to ever happen on this planet. On one end was the IWGP Heavyweight Champion Kazuchika Okada, and on the other, challenging for the title was him, as the entire wrestling community lit up across the world, holding panels, reviewing, criticizing. I was left in awe. The world was shifting again, and at the epicenter was Kenny Omega. To a layman who watches a Kenny Omega match, it might seem anything from sporadic to clean to energetic to dramatic. Well, it is because he is all these things and more. During his stint in New Japan, Kenny had shown the sheer athletic specimen that he is, with his precise ring IQ and his ability to pinpoint a target with gorgeous speed and force. His facial expressions are over the top, like watching a poorly directed melodrama series that he uses in order to tell a story. An avid gamer bordering on the lines of nerdhood, Kenny uses every element that he could find in pop culture and uses them to craft a narrative. It was his love for gaming, anime, and wrestling that played a small role in him making a permanent move from his home in Canada to Japan, where he started wrestling for an independent promotion called DDT. This initial phase was important for Kenny's career, since DDT specialized in comedy wrestling and over-the-top theatrics, a far cry from Kenny's independent days from across the Pacific, where he declined a contract for WWE's developmental facility, an offer that many aspiring wrestlers would die for. Fueling his creative side and honing his storytelling skills were far more precious to him than acquiring a big contract from the world's biggest wrestling corporation. In DDT, he was able to develop his skills when it comes to comedy wrestling. Here's him wrestling a blow-up doll, and here, he wrestles a 9-year-old girl. And here is him doing a Hadouken special attack. Since early on in his career, Kenny represents an idea to follow a path guided by passion rather than one forged by success. As important as athleticism is to a wrestling match, Kenny found it even more necessary to be able to fuse different elements of all that one loves into a giant ball of emotions. To drive this point forward, it is crucial I tell you one of, if not the most important stories in wrestling, that if given a chance, can transcend one single sport onto a wider umbrella of all art form. I am about to tell you a love story. It is the epic tale of the Golden Lovers. When Kenny went back to his hometown performing for independent promotions after his contract for WWE broke out, he watched a DDT match that featured Kota Ibushi. Drawn through an intense connection on this first sight, Kenny contacted DDT and taped a backyard match for them. Impressed by the tape, DDT invited him for a match with Ibushi. For Kenny and Ibushi, this match was magical. They fought in-ring and brawled on the outside. But for the both of them, it was an epiphany. Two young men that grew up in countries miles apart in very different cultures, Ibushi and Kenny were in a strange harmony, like they were connected. And both of them felt this. Both of them knew that what they had was special. And Kenny decided to live close to where Ibushi was and move to Japan to carry out a mission to change the world. After Kenny's contract expired with DDT, they started wrestling together in New Japan as a team. Initially dubbed to be the Golden Twins, Kenny and Ibushi sought to change the name to something they felt was more suited to them, the Golden Lovers. They were kissing in the ring and spending time outside. But the nature of the relationship was never revealed, and the ambiguity remained. They were almost like this badass couple that fought together in complete sync with such a chemistry that was unheard of before. Their bodies would align perfectly with one another as they performed with spectacular energy and indulged in charming goofy spots. We enter the second act of the story as Omega begins to find himself vulnerable in front of Ibushi's rising stature. You see, they both were special together, but Kota Ibushi was a once-in-a-generation talent and he was already being hailed as one of the best in the world. A nomad who would go where he pleases and do what he wants. And he was starting to get noticed as he began getting bigger opportunities as a single star, and Kenny fell into his massive shadows. Something that usually goes under the radar when talking about Omega, which I find extremely well done, is the way he uses pathos in his story. In his efforts to reach for Ibushi and the ceiling he created, Kenny begins to falter. He loses big match after big match, and he feels all alone. While Ibushi made a transition into the heavyweight division, for Kenny, a change was needed. And a change did happen. In November of 2014, Kenny joined the villainous stable made popular by foreign wrestlers that was meant to represent the irreverent attitudes of wrestlers in the States as opposed to Japan's more traditional ways. The stable was Bullet Club, and Kenny Omega, now being dubbed the Cleaner, showcased a more brash personality.
You fools!
After all his time learning Japanese, Kenny started speaking in English as a Bullet Club member. He let go of his lovable otaku character and started modeling his persona on badass crime fixers with a look inspired by the likes of Resident Evil and Sylvester Stallone's Cobra. But more importantly, Kenny began winning in singles matches, even defeating Yusuke Taguchi to win the Junior Heavyweight Championship in his first match as the Cleaner. His mentor and Bullet Club leader AJ Styles, now the heavyweight champion, was a far cry from what Ibushi was, and they continued to create havoc in and out of the ring. There was a sense of belonging for Kenny, until a ghost from the past returned. Ibushi had won the New Japan Cup, a premier tournament that grants the winner to face any singles championship of their choosing, and he chose to fight Styles at Invasion Attack 2015. Kenny's involvement as part of the Bullet Club tribe added complexity to the match, as it was a staple for Bullet Club members to interfere in matches in attempts to give the edge to their teammates. At a crucial moment where Ibushi had the match almost won, Kenny hesitates on his way to pull his duty and freezes. Ibushi shakes his head in disappointment at seeing what his friend had become since they separated. The moment of distraction is enough, however, for Styles to catch Ibushi in a Styles clash and win. Throughout the celebration, Kenny is conflicted. He does not cheer, rueing having to do Styles' dirty work at the cost of his friend as Ibushi lies on the floor, broken by the betrayal. After completing a stint with New Japan, Ibushi leaves to freelance again. While on the outside, it was to cope with the injuries and the burnout that comes with the grueling schedule, but on the inside, he was still deeply hurt by the events and could find no place for himself in the system. With Ibushi away, Kenny decides to put all his learnings to use as he dethrones AJ Styles to become the leader of Bullet Club himself, and shortly after, wins the IWGP Intercontinental title after a match with Tanahashi. But this time, he was a little different. Realizing his methods were not meeting his ideals, Kenny tried to reframe how Bullet Club worked. His vision was to create a stable that was noble and brave. If he is to meet Ibushi again, it would not be to be looked down at, but as an equal this time. But not every member of the Bullet Club followed this ideology, and seeds began to get planted for an eventual civil war within the stable, as Omega creates an in-group known as the Elite along with his friends, the Young Bucks. 2016 through 17 was the time Omega rose to a level not many foreign wrestlers could reach, as he wins the G1 Climax tournament, the first Kaijin in history to do so, finally bordering on the best ever category himself. The victory came with the help of a spirit though, as in a moment of struggle, he uses Kota Ibushi's last ride powerbomb to slay Hiroki Goto in the finals. With the Elite, Kenny was finally doing what he always loved, combining his otaku persona with his in-ring acumen. The YouTube channel Being the Elite became popular in the community for their quirky behind-the-scenes skits. He was finally out of the shadows of his teammate, leading his own tribe. But in his quest to be the greatest, he was stopped by arguably the greatest. After winning the G1, Kenny challenged Kazuchika Okada for the IWGP Heavyweight Championship at Wrestle Kingdom 11. At over 46 minutes, the match became the longest main event in the history of the event. Popular wrestling journalist Dave Meltzer, who rates matches on a scale of 0 to 5, broke his scale to rate the match 6 stars. A galore of wrestling finishers and reversals, the story of the match was clear. Omega trying to break into the impenetrable defense of Okada, which is a steel core that is a crucial body part that is used in order to kick out. But Okada was too much. Omega lost the match to a devastating Dreammaker, sending shockwaves across the world. Here were two men who, in the silence of their own little corner, put on one of the greatest wrestling matches ever. The funny thing is, this was not the match that I was talking about during the opening. Both finished the match with mutual respect for each other, Omega calling Okada the best wrestler in the world, and Okada dubbing Kenny the greatest Kaijin in New Japan history. The two would go on to have a trilogy of matches in the same year, all three classics in their own right. Their second match at Dominion broke the rating scale further, being rated 6.25 stars. A 60-minute time limit draw, Omega was so exhausted, he could not even stand upright to take Okada's Rainmaker. To the outside world, this match was getting thousands of new eyes in New Japan. Eyes like mine, which had never seen anything outside American wrestling. New Japan became a global giant and Omega was their brand. But inside Omega was a turmoil of his own.
I thought it was my time tonight. I said so many bad things about you, Okada.
2017 was the year Ibushi would return to New Japan for the first time in 2 years, participating in the annual G1 Climax. The Bullet Club was seeing frustrations towards Omega that was being led by Cody. Ibushi and Omega competed in different blocks, with Omega feeling destined to fight his former partner in the finals, as equals this time.
Promise me, Ibushi, that you'll make it to the finals. It's the only way we can meet.
But Ibushi failed to qualify. In the finals, Omega would lose to Naito, and backstage in a heartbreaking moment, would be confronted by Ibushi for the first time since the betrayal. But Omega is inconsolable. Once again, facing him, a lesser man. Not the best bout machine as he intended to. Among the global eyes that were centered on New Japan was a dastardly set that was locked on Kenny. Chris Jericho challenged Omega for a match at Wrestle Kingdom 12 that sold more than 30,000 tickets. While Omega faced Jericho, Ibushi fought Cody at the event, who traumatized him all the way through a day later. Cody was stopped by the leader of the Bullet Club, Kenny Omega, who saved Ibushi from the attack. The tensions between the members only seemed to worsen when on one fateful night, Cody and the others finally turned on Kenny Omega. In a charming display of emotions, Kenny was saved by Ibushi. He finds it hard to accept fate as it is. This was not how it was supposed to be. After having suppressed his feelings for more than 4 years, he could not hold it in anymore. Kenny and Ibushi embraced one more time as confetti bursts out. The fact that one of the most emotional moments in the history of professional sports was happening between two men was unbelievable. Adult men and women were crying for two guys displaying their love. The mission that began on a fateful night in 2010 reached its apex. This was such a significant moment in the history of the sport. Wrestling was never the most progressive of industries. LGBT characters were for a long time only meant to play a joker or an ironic role in mainstream wrestling. This was a revolution. And the best thing about this story is that it does not end here. The Golden Lovers is a story that transcends into a lifelong tale. With Ibushi by his side, Omega finally conquered Okada in an epic fourth encounter between the two. But unfortunately, the good times never last, like a summer vacation perhaps. And this brings us to the next chapter in the tale. To those who are familiar with Kenny Omega, know his finisher, an electric chair driver, or the Katayoku no Tenshi, is commonly known as the One-Winged Angel for its one-handed variation. Like many of Omega's moves, this too is a pop culture reference taken from the Final Fantasy games. But to me, One-Winged Angel is a bigger theme, and it's a theme that Kenny uses in his character. One-Winged Angel as a concept represents what it in fact is, a pure being haunted by the ghost of its past. It tries to take flight, but it seems to be chained down by the heaviness of the baggage. But it is an angel, and angels are obligated to perform their duties, wings clipped or intact. And I think that's beautiful. After beating Okada for the heavyweight title, Kenny became the face of not only the global expansion, but also independent wrestling at large. He, along with the other elite members, created a buzz to erect a rival for the wrestling giant WWE, the likes of which America had never seen since WCW back in the 90s. Fans had gotten a taste of a kind of wrestling that had eluded them for the better part of two decades, and it was time to give them what they wanted. This came to fruition on 1st of September 2018, when the Elite promoted an independent show called All In that became the first non-WWE or WCW wrestling event to sell 10,000 tickets in America. The show's success led to bigger shockwaves, as in a few months' time, on the eve of Wrestling Kingdom 13, the Elite would launch their own major wrestling promotion, All Elite Wrestling, in America. And at the forefront was Kenny, waiting to again change the world. But something wasn't right. This would mean Kenny would once again have to part ways with Ibushi, who decided to stay back in New Japan, showcasing his loyalty to the promotion. It is that burden Omega has to live with on his quest. The years that he spent building wrestling to a progressive place where anything and everything was accepted with open minds, he would do so at the cost of letting go of his partner, his best friend, Kota Ibushi. It pains him, but that is his duty.
I knew that if I asked for him to come here, that he would. But I knew that his dream before anything that we ever did was to win the IWGP Heavyweight belt. And
as a beloved heavyweight champion and on the verge of leaving New Japan for AEW, Kenny was in a difficult spot for his last match for New Japan. At Wrestle Kingdom 13, Kenny faced G1 winner Hiroshi Tanahashi, the former ace of New Japan, looking for one final shot at glory. But were fans ready to accept the past as their champion? Were the fans ready to believe Tanahashi still had it? In collaboration with indie game developer Toby Fox, the creator of Undertale, Kenny released a special skit for his entrance where he plays an underdog fighting a mammoth Tanahashi along with all his fans and supporters. You can find the entire clip as part of a Being the Elite episode in the description below. The match saw Kenny being a cocky champion that Tanahashi has to conquer. While there was no heel, bad guy in the match, Kenny played his part for the stacked Tokyo crowd to cheer hard for Tanahashi, who despite his critics, wins the match and the title. As for Kenny, he leaves New Japan a villain. And though he enters America a hero, he doesn't find it quite as easy to adapt as it was in Japan. In his new role, he provides star-making performances for wrestlers unknown to the world, as well as for already huge stars looking to brand themselves differently than what they were in WWE. But he's lost the connect he once had. Being looked as an overhyped cosplayer and a shell of his former self, Kenny begins getting more and more disconnected from his fans, from his friends, and even his new tag partner. The burden of expectations seems to be heavy. Doesn't matter if he consistently puts on great matches from week to week, as long as he is not putting on 40-minute classics, something seems very wrong. And that is where Kenny is underrated, the ability to perform his role while maintaining a rich emotional output that leads to catharsis. I've been inspired by Kenny Omega in more ways than you could think a wrestler could inspire someone. He embraces emotions and his own passion to paint a charming picture that could resonate with the entire world, because we all feel them. We all feel vulnerable and alone. Kenny uses those to create pathos, unlike anyone, in my experience at least. And he does it because he's passionate. I'm glad I could watch a cultural revolution happen right before my eyes. For the longest time, I felt disconnected from everything around me, even films. I could not experience the joy that comes with watching your favorite team win the World Cup or seeing a favorite filmmaker win an award. I wasn't watching wrestling when Stone Cold created a storm during the Attitude Era, but I took notice when Kenny Omega was creating landmarks in the world of pro wrestling, and I'll be there when he does it the next time, perhaps reuniting with his golden lover once again. But for now, I'll allow him his sweet time. I imagined wrestling to be an escape, a guilty pleasure, but it turned out to be much more to me. I see stories forming in every ring, and I learn things from these stories as part of my journey. I'm learning to embrace my passion and finding a tribe that is open-minded. I would never imagine wrestling would do that for me. And that is how Kenny Omega changed the way I look at wrestling. I bid you adieu, until another time.
Goodbye!